tall next to the mighty Mississippi is the symbol that shapes our great city, St. Louis's Gateway Arch.
This is really a magnificent icon.
It's part of who we are.
It's a welcoming point for people that come from all over the world.
The arch was designed to express our nation's westward expansion, but now it's cut off from the city by a busy intersection, and the riverfront beneath it could be so much more than it is today. That's why an initiative was formed to reimagine one of the most visited icons in the world. The initiative, City Arch River. The plan, create an experience under the arch as memorable as the arch itself. I'm Virginia Kerr. In the next 30 minutes, we'll take a look back at the construction of the arch, give you an update on the renovation project, and show you what the arch will soon look like.
From the nation standpoint, the arch is iconic.
It is a symbol for our city, one that is recognized worldwide.
It's always changing. I don't think I've ever looked at the arch and it's looked exactly the same.
It represents a gateway for innovation, for collaboration.
It's always beautiful, it's always kind of different, but I think the constant of it is that it's kind of rooted right there in the soil of St. Louis.
Next year marks 50 years since the construction of the arch, and we're going to show you what the next 50 years and beyond will look like.
So the arch is turning 50. It's going to be a big birthday party. The next 50 years here in St. Louis, I'm incredibly optimistic. I'm optimistic because I see more collaboration in the city than I've ever seen before.
There'll be plenty to do and fun things to see on one visit or two visits or 10 visits.
Stay relevant, stay fresh. Don't leave it alone as we did 50 years ago and expect it to kind of take care of itself.
A place that's going to be more beautiful, a place that's going to be more welcoming, and a place that'll help us develop business and more tourism for the economy and for the region.
We never want this area to become stale.
I think we'll see a city that's more developed. I think we'll see a community that's vibrant. And I think we'll see the emergence of brand new industries and technologies coming to St. Louis. And this will be a really, really cool place to live.
It's a beautiful structure.
It's a spectacular piece of architecture.
Everyone knows the arch. It means it's the symbol of St. Louis, basically.
It amazes me.
Well, I know St. Louis was a gateway to the West, and so the Gateway Arch is a symbol of that. And I have pioneer ancestors who went west, and so I'm thinking a lot about them today.
To truly understand the arch's future, we must first look back at the past.
The arch itself came about as a result of an architectural competition that was held in 1947. So it was 12 years after the park was created that they got around to actually try to decide, what's this memorial going to look like? What are we going to do with this 90 acres of land that we've got on the riverfront? So they had a competition and they got 172 entries. They were very wildly different from one another. And having seen almost all of the 172, I would say the one they chose was the very best. It was submitted by a man named Eero Saarinen. His design featured this gigantic stainless steel arch and a number of buildings, museums, and restaurants and things like that that were kind of clustered around it, plus this beautiful kind of urban forest that would surround the arch. He and his landscape architect, Dan Kiley, said, we want the arch to seem like it's just springing up out of this forest, you know, when people see it. It took quite a long time to actually implement that design. It depended on the U.S. government having a balanced budget, which we did in 1956. Eero Saarinen, his landscape architect Dan Kiley, started to sort of reimagine the project because it had really sat around for about 10 years since the competition, and decide, well, what is this arch really going to look like? How tall is it really going to be? What materials is it going to be made out of? Can we really build it? You know, engineering-wise, can it really be done?
When we put the first section in, it was everything was new. Yeah, just assembling it on the job site. How would it handle with our lifting devices? So there was a little bit of tension, I think. It worked. There were a lot of things that we learned when we put the first one down, that when we put the second one down, it worked a little better. We had a lot of very good engineering. The original design was perfect. The iron workers that worked on the job were good people.
From the very beginning, when they start putting footings for each leg of the arch down, and they started building it up, there was a lot of speculation as to whether or not this last piece was going to fit.
All the historic arches going back in time to the ancient Romans, the weight of the arch comes in on the capstone or cornerstone, and without that piece, it just falls over.
I remember the day it happened. It was October 28th. It happened to be my dad's birthday that day. And I remember it seemed like the entire world was watching to see if this last piece would fit.
But the fire department had to come hose down the south leg of the arch because it was so hot it wouldn't, the keystone wasn't going to make it. And after they finished that, they waited and waited and waited and waited.
I remember the Boy Scouts, yes, they presented us with a flag and we put it on the section.
I remember everything from the whole day when we walked down from the center part down to the last piece, and they had the last piece sitting there, put the flag on, raised it. Once we raised the flag, I saluted, and we walked back as a color guard.
And that's a tradition for the highest part of a structure, to have a flag on it when the iron workers put it up.
We knew it was something special, but we didn't realize it until years later that this was something that was really, really special, that it was history.
You saw the great crane bring it around.
But once the arch settled down from the hot summer day, those two center lines met basically within the circumference of a dime. So it worked.
And it was a fabulous day. And it frankly glued me to St. Louis.
Once it did work and it did fit, a lot of jubilation around St. Louis, and something I felt as well personally.
First of all, it was a relief. You can't say that you didn't worry about it. You were concerned, but I was never worried that it wouldn't work. It was just nice that when it's there, it's finished. You knew all your work for 4 or 5 years was worthwhile, and it worked.
Saarinen's design is amazing still today.
Today, I'm afraid too many people go to the garage in the north end of the park, visit the park, and then leave. And the signs show them where to get on the interstate to get out of town, and we want to change that.
The project first broke ground on August 2nd, 2013, but it was years in the making.
City Arch River came to be through the vision of civic leaders in St. Louis who understood that we were not getting as much value out of this wonderful resource as we could.
There was a concern that the park, you say, was getting kind of tired. Visitation had plateaued out. The Secretary of the Interior at the time said, let's do a quick general management plan to engage the public, see what we can do. And that we did that plan in record time. And the message from our plan was, let's weave the park into the city. Let's not have it stand alone, walled off by the interstates and the river, but make it part of the city.
It was a critical document, and it was brought to us by Jack Danforth and Secretary Kempthorne, in effect, because it called for an international design competition, which took the new park out of the hands of the amateurs and said, let's have the type of competition that brought us Arrow Saarinen. Important, important moment. And from that general management plan, we have Michael Van Valkenburg's brilliant reimagining of the experience.
And at that time, City Arch River was formed, and the rest is history. We've really moved along.
So City Arch River is raising the money, paid for the design, is coordinating all the partners, bringing us together, making sure the plans are coordinated. And then we're also planning for the future.
I'd tell you that the project was started in 1934, and it hasn't been finished yet.
I think it's great for the city. I think we'll have more visitors now to come because it'll be an easy access to get to the arch to be able to see everything.
So in August, we had a wonderful groundbreaking for the whole project.
It was a wonderful day. Claire McCaskill presided, but that was a day when transportation, parks, interior, everybody who's so deeply involved in this project stood in one place.
And we had hundreds of people in the park, and it was really a terrific outpouring of support.
It finally became real to a lot of people who had just been watching, thinking, there it goes. But when you start tearing up roads, people take you seriously.
Yeah, I mean, it's a huge area. I mean, they could do a lot more, especially, you know, for the kids.
More entertainment or put a garden under it or something.
I'm not sure people appreciate how beautiful our arts grounds are.
I think the reason the arch fits in with nature is because it's this graceful curve and it's so, so simple.
The winner of the City Arch River competition in 2010 was Michael Van Valkenburg Associates. They're one of the foremost landscape architecture firms in the country. And Michael Van Valkenburg, who's a landscape architect himself, loves this Dan Kiley landscape.
He's really at the cusp of modernism, and this project is one of the most unique projects for him as well. The geometry and of the alley is just brilliant. But you can see a lot of indicators, at least as a landscape architect, of the trouble that the landscape is having. Yes, the trees are big, but they should be so much bigger for 50 years of growth. So we're bringing in over 800 London plane trees, which are now in a temporary nursery.
Great species for this location because they can handle different weather environments, so they can handle if it goes into a little bit of a drought period, they can handle the wet periods without having any problems. They're relatively insect and disease free.
This will realize Kylie's vision of a cathedral-like space along these alleys.
As far as moving this many trees of this scale, this size, it's never been done before. This is one of the first times that something like this has ever been created. So in essence, it's kind of a historical event to what we're actually accomplishing here.
The City Arch River project is not just a one-liner project. It's a whole suite of solutions. Biggest change is that we are trying as much as possible to erase the experience of I-70 as you come from downtown St. Louis to the primary destination of the museum, which will have a west-facing facade and entry, and the arch itself. That is an amazing undertaking because we essentially had to reconfigure in collaboration with the city of downtown St. Louis, all of the roadway networks, how people are arriving, the Mississippi River Bridge. All that was a perfectly timed to rethink the vehicle experience so that we could make a much more generous pedestrian, bike experience for entering and also spending time on site.
Be introducing more sustainable landscaping practices. The water will reflect the image of the arch in the future because they will not collect algae as they do today, because we will not have as much stormwater runoff, not as much fertilizer. There'll be bioswales around the ponds to collect some of this water. In addition, we will be adding 7.5 acres of new park space on the north end of the grounds, where there actually will be very significant changes.
It's featuring a really interesting piece that since the competition, we've fought to keep a piece in for kids. And we're calling it the Explorer's Garden. It's themed around plantings that Meriwether Lewis discovered, and it's basically a place scaled for kids to run around and explore, get rid of that energy that they haven't been able to expend in the car, all within eyesight of parents, and it's something we've done in several other parks, and kids just love it.
This is a big deal. It'll really refurbish the arch grounds and make it a place where more people will want to come more often and stay longer.
And as more and more people live in St. Louis, particularly in the Washington Avenue corridor, lofts, et cetera, we want this also to be a place where you can come every day with your kids and just sort of relax.
I'm sure it'll be wonderful once they get it all done.
Crossing the streets and the traffic downtown is a little crazy at times.
It's such a challenge for us to get from the arch grounds to the courthouse, which is such a great field trip.
This used to be a busy intersection people had to navigate. Soon it will be the entrance to the newly improved and expanded museum.
MoDOT's piece of this puzzle is to build the land bridge that goes from Luther Eli Square Park over to the arch grounds.
A lot of people visit. I mean, you can look at the activity now around the arch grounds, and there are a lot of people. This new land bridge is going to be an unbelievable opportunity for those people to get from one side of downtown over onto the arch grounds.
There's not a lot of them in the United States, and this definitely it's our very first in Missouri to build. It'll have trees on it that are 30 feet tall, shrubs, decorative lighting. It's just going to be a nice place to hang out and walk from downtown to the arch and then all the way to the river.
When it's built, you know, the highway will still be at both ends, but you'll be less aware of the highway that's going right underneath it.
We also replaced the Walnut Bridge over the depressed lanes of the interstate here, and we've already completed that process. So that bridge went back and it's twice as wide as it originally was.
We have that bridge back up in, I believe, 50 days through one of the worst, coldest winters we've had. And the day we poured the bridge deck, which I think was the middle of February, was a beautiful, almost like spring day, so it worked out really, really well.
When big construction comes in, we've heard from the public that it's easier for MoDOT to come in, close it down, tear it up, repair it, get it back open to the public as soon as possible. So when we have the opportunity to make a big impact and get a lot of work done over a weekend by closing the interstate, we'll do that.
This is, I would say, the kind of the start of it. And we get this land bridge done and then all the other work at the arch grounds, yeah, it'll be a nice job.
It is. It's overdue. I've been on that highway many times. They can eliminate that.
It's just so beautiful to see the city and to see the barges going up the Mississippi. Just amazing.
Well, this is one of the greatest rivers in the world. And, you know, people talk to us all the time who come in from out of town. They want to see the river. There's very few places in the world that have a river as great as the Mississippi. And so I think it's important to honor that. So as you look down there, you're seeing the walls come up out of the ground, and we are elevating Lenore K. Sullivan up about 2.5 feet. So we'll be above the 100-year floodplain almost. You'll be able to have a new riverfront promenade with new events and festivals. We're building a new bike trail that connects from our Shoto Avenue trailhead to the Confluence Trail up north at Biddle Street. So it's a part of the overall river ring that the district is building. And so the riverfront is a key component of that. But I think what's most exciting is you can experience it in a way that we haven't been able to in years. But we're also gonna have new festivals. We're working on art exhibits, temporary art exhibits. So a lot going on down there. Captain's Return will be elevated with everything else. It'll have a new spot of honor just near the north leg of the arch down on the riverfront. In addition to rebuilding the riverfront, we are also responsible for administering the funds from Proposition P, which was passed in St. Louis City and County last April, and we will be redeveloping the arch grounds. It's a working river, so we need to tell that story. It's not a place where you pop in a canoe. It's a place that you just sort of take in because of its historic significance, because of its transportation importance. So there's a lot about this great river that we need to talk about and give people the opportunity to explore.
A beautiful, accessible green space will soon surround our beloved arch.
Today, you may not realize it, but if you're in a wheelchair, it's hard to visit this park. And it's certainly almost impossible to get down to the river. That's all gonna change.
So one of the new ways that you'll be able to get from the arch grounds down to the river are what's called the East Slope Pathways. So they will be on both ends of the arch grounds going around the existing train, and you'll be able to just take a beautiful path with gardens around it all the way down to the river. You know, often we're out here and we see people carrying wheelchairs up the grand staircase or, you know, holding onto the rail carefully step by step. So this is going to be a great chance for people to have a new, accessible, safe way to experience the river in a really delightful garden landscape experience.
The slopes are regraded in a way that it creates a lawn. So if you're comfortable sitting in the lawn, it's a tremendous place to grab lunch from a food truck, sit out there, and be on the riverfront, which I think is a really missing experience in downtown St. Louis.
You're going to be able to get from the river to the old courthouse without even walking up one set of stairs or one step.
It's the biggest man-made monument in the United States, so spectacular.
We came from Northern Illinois to see a friend, and I had to come to the arch. I've never done it, so I had to do it.
To me, it's a symbol of the expansion to the West, and you know, being able to come here, it was just amazing, just a great experience.
Soon the museum will take on a whole new look.
I don't think anybody yet has the full comprehension of how much it's going to change. This museum is what's going to surprise people now.
The museum was never planned to completion during Saarinen's lifetime. It was many years before a museum was designed, and a man named Aram Martirosyan, who had actually worked for Saarinen at one time, designed the museum we currently have, and that was finished in 1976.
This, when it was installed, was very innovative, and the idea of getting across a landscape, people in a landscape, through time, and that's what they were trying to do. What I'm trying to do is bring it up 40 years from that time.
We still have a 1976 museum that's under the arch, and a lot of things have changed in the way that museums are built and run and the things that are available for people to see and do in museums since 1976. We, for instance, really don't have anything that people can touch. We don't have anything that's interactive for kids. All those things are kind of expected in museums today.
That we were going to take what we call an expressive approach, which was not to say, this is the history, learn it, find out. We're asking people to find out, and by posing questions, you know, who were the people who went? What were the motivations? Why did they go? Would you have done that the same way? What did you, if you're going west, what would you take? And you do that by making it highly interactive, a lot of dynamic footage, a lot of film.
I think it's an opportunity for us to be able to tell our story even better than we tell it now.
Really focusing on this exact area, what was happening on the arch grounds 200, 300 years ago.
History is under your feet, where you're standing. This is where it happened. Not down the road, not down the river, not up the river. People lived and breathed and died and had their experiences here. And if we can make that connection for the visitor, I think it's a much more a personal, emotional connection. And emotional connections are the best.
People are going to enter the facility and they're going to walk right through the museum to get to the tram ride to the top of the arch.
So you'll be coming through that wall at the far end, coming towards us. It's this idea of you meeting the people going west. And so we have three 16 by 10 aspect ratio glass screens that you walk through. And then behind that, there's seven smaller people-sized screens. And so as you're walking in, you can see the grass across the prairies, you can see different landscapes, you can see the water. And then all of a sudden, you'll see a herd of bison charge across your path.
And so we're hoping that the museum is going to be not sort of just an adjunct to what we do, but it'll be an integral part of the story that we tell and the visitor experience that everybody gets when they come.
So at the end of the whole experience, when we're looking in the lobby area where we're standing now, we're calling it a dream wall at the moment. It's about the dream of making the arch and the people who made the arch. And it's going to be a multi-screen, the whole width of the room. 50% of the people don't actually go up the arch. They've either been before or they're waiting for their friends. And so, in the lobby here, we'll have a section of the arch, the last section that was put in there, reconstructed down here. So the people who can't get up into the trams will be able to sort of stand in there and see the things on this level, they can't do now. So this was an opportunity for those to sort of, who can't or don't want to, or they're claustrophobic or have other issues, to experience what it's like to see those fantastic views.
People are get it, Park Over Highway. They're getting that the North Parking Garage is coming down, so we're reunited with Eads Bridge, another National Historic Landmark. People get it that we're now going to have slopes to get you to the riverfront. What people don't get is the new entry to the arch west, looking at the old courthouse, how that will unite the courthouse arch experience, and then the interactive but also hands-on museum that will be there. Completely, absolutely different than the experience that's there today.
Tourists are going to love it.
And especially looking west and imagining the dreams of the people who got here.
I've got grandchildren that love to do the interactive stuff, so yes, that would be a plus.
On May 13th, Vice President Biden came to visit the City Arch River Project area.
I've seen it 1,000 times on television. I've been in and out of the city 50 times over the years since it's been here, but I've never actually been down here and looked up. It is breathtaking.
I think it shows that the folks in Washington care about the community. rising up and using some government money, but our own money, to revitalize a national treasure.
And so it's always been visionaries that have led this country, and it's always been, quite frankly, the federal government has never done it itself. We've never built all of this. What we've always been able to do is help be part of the vision, provide seed money, and to attract the kinds of investment that are needed to complete these projects.
We don't stop. We're not near stopping. So it's a nice interim visit. We're delighted that the Vice President came to show the national interest, but we've got a way to go. We're here to finish the construction so that we can really get into the programming and make this space all it should be about the future of the nation, but the future of St. Louis.
I think it means it's something that people can identify with and mark as their own in a very geographical way.
It's not only a symbol of St. Louis, but it's a nationwide symbol that, you know, everyone recognizes. And
I think it would be great for St. Louis as a whole.
This project takes a whole community pulling together.
Yes, this is finishing Saarinen's vision, but more important, it is an extraordinary opportunity for the region.
And I think the arch is such an optimistic thing. It stands for the future, and it speaks to the heart of America and expansion.
This is a huge investment, hundreds of millions of dollars invested in this icon and the riverfront and connecting these two, the river and the arch, to downtown.
There is some federal money, and that's what's doing the park over the highway, but everything else is big donors and small donors, so that's a history of the arch. The arch is one of the few national parks that was in part paid for by the local citizens.
And we need everybody, even if it's only a dollar, $5, $20, $100.
Because I think the experience itself is going to be something we can't even imagine until we do it.
Monsanto got involved in the project really early. We have 4,500 people here in St. Louis who live and work here. We are proud to be St. Louis grown. So from a community point of view, it was the right thing to do.
And Emerson was founded here 125 years ago downtown, just like many other corporations that are giving to this. And we felt quite strongly that we needed to give something back to revitalize downtown St. Louis and to make it a better place for the next generation.
These are the spots when you're looking straight up at it. And doesn't it all just say to you there's something next, there's something new, there's a future?
You can be a part of history by helping with this transformation. To find out how, go to cityarchriver.org as we reimagine St. Louis and the Arch, our treasured monument.
Generous individuals and organizations throughout the region are stepping up to support the City Arch River 2015 campaign. Thank you for this outstanding support.